pulmonary fibrosis. It's a scarring of the lung tissue, which makes breathing difficult. Oh, now I think of it. Thanks to some surplus miles from the year before, I got to my 36,000 cycling miles before I turned 81 a couple months ago in January. But last summer, I was huffing and puffing on the hills. So I asked the nurse, is that okay? She said, well, it's okay to huff and puff, but can you still talk when you're huffing and puffing? I said, no. She said, you're exerting yourself too much. Oh, so I gotta stay off the hill? I recommend it, she said. But what is New Hampshire for cycling without hills? Well, later I started having trouble even cycling on flat roads. After rehab, my numbers looked better for a while. But then on January 8th, 2 months ago, I had a bad spell, terrible day. Coughing hard, breathing hard, a bit shaky, I had to sit. Later, the chest x-ray showed that the fibrosis was worse, with increasing shortness of breath and fatigue. The doctor prescribed prednisone plus oxygen. Yikes. I asked a good doctor about driving. Well, he didn't snap a no, but he said, I don't recommend it. Oh, no. And interestingly enough, my sister in Florida, 3 years older than I, has the same darn thing. Well, I lost 14 pounds, she's lost 40 pounds. Her doctor said her labored breathing and heavy coughing requires lots of energy, lots of calories. My doctor mentioned that I was in for some major life changes. Oh, probably no more cycling. But I've been cycling for 68 years, since the seventh grade. We had no training wheels in those days. So I was a late learner, but I made up for a lost time later. And probably no more driving. Well, I've been driving since 16 and 53. Perhaps no more preaching. But I've been preaching for 60 years, since I was a junior in college. No more staying at annual conference overnight, which I've done for 55 years.
And you'll actually miss. You'll actually miss that. Unless some of us.
Some of us. More talent, more discipline.
Amen,
and some of us, we don't have all the responsibilities that some younger pastors have. And besides, I didn't like traveling back and forth. So, and no more singing. But I've been singing since junior choir in my home church. And I lost not only 14 pounds, I lost my wedding ring.
Oh, no.
That was perhaps loose. Now, to face all these losses in one day or so, I was really bummed out. I'm in shell shock. Now, I've known people who've experienced different losses, but not usually several all at once at the same time. What could have caused this rather sudden change in my health? Some of you know I had excellent health until I was 80, and then things happened. There are all kinds of pollutants in the air that we breathe, but when I told my doctor, my sister and I were exposed to loose asbestos on the coal furnace in our cellar 70 years ago. My doctor said that would be about the right time for it to take its toll. My sister's doctor said the same thing. Our parents would have been shocked to learn of this. Well, as a pastor, I know a little bit about the dynamics of grief. I could feel myself sinking into a poor me mode, a self-pity party. Some of you know what that is? Okay, thank you. If I left myself, I could get mad at God, the world, and everybody else. No, What I needed to do was to identify and objectify each of the losses, the different losses, and see how I might begin to cope, lest I lose hope. So let's turn now to the Lord for the next song response.
Healing. Hear now these words from the Gospel of Luke. At sunset, the people brought to Jesus all who had various kinds of sickness, and laying his hands on each one, he healed them. And then later in Luke, one Sabbath, when Jesus went to share a meal in the home of one of the leaders of the Pharisees, they were watching him closely. A man suffering from dropsy, which is an abnormal swelling of the body, otherwise known as edema or swollen ankles. This man was there. Jesus asked the lawyers and the Pharisees, the religious leaders, "Does the law allow healing on the Sabbath or not?" But they said nothing. Jesus took hold of the sick man, cured him, and then let him go.
Edema, swollen ankle. But to regain perspective, I needed to list not only the losses, but also the positives that were beginning to appear. First, I listened to my body for the losses I was experiencing. But then I began to listen to my mind and my spirit for some positives. In addition to physical and medical support, there was emotional support of family. Even their grandchildren started coming by more often. Yes, the emotional and spiritual support of family, friends, our Bold Church community, our community at Havenwood, with lots of prayers, emails, handwritten notes, thank you, Joy, telephone calls, visitors coming by, new neighbors in our neighborhood. And they're in their 90s. They just turned 95.
Wow.
She called and said she was coming over with Bill. They wanted to bring me a plate of sweet treats. I think they wanted to sweeten up my disposition that had soured for a while. I also heard from a somewhat younger pastor whom I'd known for years. He promptly sent an email the next morning after learning of my situation. I was moved to tears by what he wrote in that email. I had no idea how important I've been to him over the years. Sometimes it takes something unusual for people to say what they might not have said before. I was so grateful. Whether in person or by mail, or phone. Some people's visits are wonderful. They're like a booster shot without the sting. And in your own ministry to others, never underestimate the importance of your prayers, cards, emails, telephone calls, or visits. The important thing is to respond, even if just briefly. There are many parts in God's healing process. As a pastor, I can tell you, I have known some people over the years suddenly in a terrible situation, and they have virtually nobody to be there for them. For whatever reason, neither family, nor church, nor any other supportive community. It is so sad. Sometimes they end up doing crazy things and making the situation worse. Well, 3 months ago, I never imagined I'd be on prednisone and oxygen most of the time. But I'm coughing less. I've gained back 5 pounds. I still get winded very easily. The 2 oxygen tanks are good for 3 hours each. Yes, I'm learning different ways to cope, which in turn gives me hope. Mary Ellen even added a protein supplement to my diet. One of the secrets of growing old gracefully is to make friends with younger people. I've been working at this for years. As we get older, well, you know what happens, our peers die. Brian, a young Korean man, whom I mentored for 10 sessions, is now enrolled in a doctoral program at the BU School of Theology. He's also planting a church. He credits me for how well things are going for him. I think that's a bit of a stretch. But he came up from Boston to visit and to provide lunch for me. 4 other people, 20 to 45 years younger than I am, have all asked to come at different times, visit, have lunch together, and good conversation. I just feel so blessed. And I encourage you, make friends with younger people. A few weeks ago, I had a call from a teacher at the Merrimack Middle School, Merrimack Valley Middle School, telling me of their celebrating Black African History Black African American History during February. Could I come and share my experience of being in the march on Montgomery with Dr. King? That was back 1965, 53 years ago. Well, with my being an old man with a cane on oxygen and winded easily, I hesitated. These kids might think I'm an antique here to speak. The teacher said she'd already told the kids, no problem. If you can handle it, they can handle it. Okay. And I got to thinking, I was 28 back in 65, and there aren't many of us still left alive to tell the story. So maybe I should try to work it out. I get winded if I stand for long. That's why I'm sitting on a stool. She said we'd be in the gym, all 200 of us. If I could climb the 5 stairs, I could sit in a chair on stage, have a table to my left for the oxygen tank, and a stand for the microphone. As long as I don't talk too fast, I'd probably be fine. Well, Adam heard of our church, transported me, and he said I did fine. God bless that. After I shared a piece that I wrote earlier for the Concord Monitor, reflecting on my experience, let me say, on the 30th anniversary, in 95, I wrote a piece for the Concord Monitor. And then some of you know I updated that for the 50th anniversary. even a Sunday, and I preached that Sunday. But I sent a copy of this to the teacher in charge, and she made 200 copies, so each kid had his own copy. And apparently they read it ahead of time. So when I finished my comments, some ad-libbing, in addition to the article, they were ready with questions and comments. Some were fascinated to think, I got to ask Dr. King a question earlier in Boston, and I still had my little green notebook that I pulled out of my pocket with lots of notes before, during, and after the march. And also, a 3x5 card with Joan Baez's autograph. She sang for us at the big rally in the St. Jude Gymnasium the night before. And then as we became airborne, leaving the Atlanta airport, she sang from the back of the plane, "We Shall Overcome." It was a spiritual experience I'll never forget. At the end of the period, students asked me to sit again so they could gather around for a picture. They treated me like a celebrity. I got to thinking, I guess I'm glad I did do this. I may be disabled, but by thinking things through, I can still do some things that I like to do. We all need a purpose for living. I believe God is still leading me forward and still has more for me to do. To my surprise, 2 weeks ago, I received a big packet of mail from the Merrimack Valley School with 60 thank you notes, a great variety of notes, some of which moved me to tears. I can tell you, in 60 years of preaching and public speaking, I've never received such a response. May God bless these youth. A few days later, a friend of my granddaughter, Jessica, called. And as a child, Alex Markhart came here with Jessica to Archer Dislocation Bible School. Now a registered dietitian, she called to see if she could come and talk a bit about my diet with an eye to helping me gain back the weight I lost. So, after tracking my diet for several meals, she'll make some suggestions. And I'm thinking, you know, there really are many potential instruments of God's healing grace. Praise God for each and every one who is an instrument of God's healing grace. Our next hymn, When Jesus Passed Through Galilee, references several of Jesus' healings as recorded in the Gospels.
Thank you.
As most of you know, during Lent, we've had an emphasis on listening. I can tell you, one of the challenges for me as a pastor is knowing when to speak up and when to shut up and listen. I close now with a true story entitled, Faithful Disciples Have Listening Ears. A United Methodist pastor was providing care to a community and a family as a consequence of a tragic accidental death of a teenager. The funeral director called the pastor and indicated the funeral home staff needed help. Pastor, we have 35 youth here viewing the body and they're emotionally upset. Please come and help. The pastor went immediately into the room of grieving teenagers. As he entered, they all expected him to say something. Instead, the pastor said, tell me about your friend. Tell me about your friend. Someone else, tell me about your friend. For an hour, they shared about their friend. The teens recognized the depth of their loss without the pastor saying another word. He offered a brief prayer, and the gathering was over. The story is a reminder that many times what is needed is not advice or words of comfort. What really is needed is a listening ear. I'm becoming convinced a mark of faithful discipleship is not having the answers, but rather having listening ears. What people really need is a good listener. Amen.
Thank you. During the season of Lent, we are taking significant time to visit our prayer stations, much like a mini pilgrimage within our sanctuary. This week, as we travel to the various prayer stations, I invite you to pay attention to what the voices in your head are saying about your external circumstances. Take time not to simply judge those voices or wish they weren't there, but rather look upon them in the light of God's love and allow God to help you let them go. We have places to light candles, to write a prayer request for yourself or someone else, to share with prayer beads, to let go of worry and regret, to perhaps kneel and pray. You might simply spend time at your seats writing in the Listen booklets insights about life and faith. During this time, we also invite you to come forward to offer your gifts for at our offering station, as well as offering to God thanksgiving for all the blessings we have given. As always, feel free to use any station, some of them, all of them, or none of them. They will be here again next week. This is your time, your appointment with God. We're going to take about 5 minutes to journey around the sanctuary and journey in our hearts and minds to greet God and to listen for what God has to say to us in prayer today. May we join together in singing our prayer song.